Welcome to this next segment of the chemistry of beer. Our topic for this segment is the tricarboxylic acid cycle, or mercifully abbreviated, the TCA cycle. It's also called the Krebs cycle or the citric acid cycle. And please excuse me if I accidentally interchange those names, but I'll try to stay consistent and use the TCA cycle. We will begin our discussion by considering the big picture. What does the tricarboxylic acid cycle do for an organism? Next, we'll discuss the gateway reaction, how pyruvate is converted to acetyl-CoA, because it's actually acetyl-CoA that enters the citric acid cycle. Then we'll discuss the entire pathway, and we'll make connections with the electron transport chain and oxidative phosphorylation. Finally, we'll try to tie up some loose ends and summarize our discussion. Our first reaction to consider is sometimes called the gateway reaction. Glycolysis, which we discussed previously, occurs in the cytosol. It produces two pyruvates. The two pyruvates are able to pass through both the relatively porous outer mitochondrial membrane and through the inner mitochondrial membrane via pyruvate transporters. Once inside the matrix of the mitochondrion, the pyruvates are oxidatively decarboxylated to form acetyl-CoAs. This sequence of reactions is catalyzed by the pyruvate dehydrogenase, or PDH, complex, which, as the name implies, is made up of several different subunits. The PDH reactions can be summarized as follows. Pyruvate plus our old friend NAD+, plus coenzyme A, form acetyl-CoA plus carbon dioxide plus NADH. We can take another view of this reaction with the help of this diagram. This explicitly shows the structure of pyruvate, which you all hopefully know by now, and it shows the loss of CO2. Once that happens, we have a two-carbon fragment. This two-carbon fragment is transferred to coenzyme A to make acetyl-CoA, and in the process, our cofactor NAD+ is reduced to NADH. Now the diagram says that this NADH can go to the electron transport chain, and so keep that in mind because that's a topic we're definitely going to encounter. So now we are ready to discuss the TCA cycle. This diagram here shows the complete TCA cycle. However, it has, for our purposes, a bit too much detail. Instead, we're going to use the help of another diagram. This diagram allows us to focus on some of the more salient features of this cycle. If you go on and take a full biochemistry course, you will go in depth in your study of the TCA cycle. But again, for our purposes, this diagram is sufficient. Remember the gateway reaction. The pyruvate dehydrogenase reaction formed acetyl-CoA. Acetyl-CoA, which we're mainly interested in this two-carbon fragment of acetyl-CoA, it condenses with the four-carbon compound oxaloacetate. This forms the six-carbon compound citrate. Citrate then undergoes an isomerization reaction to make isocitrate. Isocitrate is then oxidatively decarboxylated to make alpha-ketoglutarate, a five-carbon-containing compound. This reaction forms NADH. Again, I want to draw your attention to this. Note all the points at which we form NADH. The other product, since we're decarboxylating isocitrate, is CO2. The alpha-ketoglutarate is also oxidatively decarboxylated, so we go from a 5-carbon alpha-ketoglutarate to a 4-carbon molecule called succinyl-CoA. And during this reaction sequence, NAD+ is reduced to NADH, we release carbon dioxide, and we bring in coenzyme A to attach to the succinyl moiety to make the succinyl-CoA. So we started with a 4-carbon compound, oxaloacetate. It condensed with the 2-carbon fragment from acetyl-CoA, the acetyl fragment, we made a 6-carbon molecule citrate. It isomerized to isocitrate, and then we had 2 steps where we lost CO2. So we're back to our 4-carbon compound, or our 4-carbon fragment, since it's attached to coenzyme A. Our succinyl-CoA then undergoes a reaction whereby we form succinate, and in the process form GTP, guanosine triphosphate. Guanosine triphosphate we can think of as being energetically equivalent to adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. The succinate then undergoes a dehydration reaction to form fumarate. So we start with a 4-carbon compound, and we still have a 4-carbon compound, but it's undergone a dehydration reaction, and those electrons have been used to reduce the cofactor FAD to FADH2. Now the FADH2 will further hand off the electrons to Q, which stands for coenzyme Q or ubiquinone, and that forms QH2. And that's going to be part of our discussion for the electron transport chain. So moving back to fumarate, our next reaction catalyzes the hydration of the double bond of fumarate to make malate. And specifically, not shown on this diagram, but it's L-malate. That is the stereochemistry. L-malate is then oxidized back to our starting compound, oxaloacetate, and in the process, NAD plus is reduced to NADH. So let's summarize. We start with oxaloacetate, a 4-carbon containing compound, and it condenses with the acetyl group, the 2-carbon fragment of acetyl-CoA, and forms the 6-carbon citrate. We have 2 decarboxylations, during which we form NADHs. We form 1 GTP, that's referred to as a substrate-level phosphorylation reaction. We form 1 FADH2, and the remaining reactions get us back to oxaloacetate, and in the process, form another NADH. So we want to keep track, we want to keep that in our minds, what happens to the NADHs and the FADH2. So now we're ready to think about the fate of NADH and FADH2. Because the citric acid cycle occurs in the matrix of the mitochondrion, that is where we're forming the NADH and the FADH2. The NADH hands its electrons off to a complex, which is simply referred to quite frequently as complex 1. So as NADH is reoxidized back to NAD+, electrons are handed off through complex 1. While this occurs, hydrogen ions, or protons from the matrix, are moved from the matrix to the intermembrane space. Recall that mitochondria have an outer membrane and an inner membrane, and so the protons are moved from the matrix to the intermembrane space. As the electrons move through complex 1, they're transferred to Q, which I mentioned earlier. This is ubiquinone. It's basically an electron carrier that moves within the bilayer of the inner mitochondrial membrane. The electrons move from reduced Q through complex 3, where more protons are translocated from the matrix to the intermembrane space. Then the electrons go one at a time to cytochrome C. We actually need 2 cytochrome Cs to accomplish this. The electrons pass from cytochrome C to complex 4, where more protons are then pumped out from the matrix to the intermembrane space, where finally oxygen is our final electron acceptor, and it accepts the electrons and is reduced to water. What we've accomplished by handing the electrons off down the electron transport chain is to capture some of that free energy in the form of an electrochemical potential. We have a higher hydrogen ion concentration in the inner membrane space with respect to the matrix. Those hydrogen ions can then move in through ATP synthase, And as that occurs, this helps bring about the formation of ATP. Actually, it helps bring about the release of tightly bound ATP. As we noted on the previous slide, succinate is one of the intermediates of the citric acid cycle. As succinate undergoes the dehydration reaction to form fumarate, those electrons are handed off to FAD to make FADH2. This occurs in complex 2, shown on the bottom of this scheme. Those electrons move through complex 2 to coenzyme Q, or ubiquinone, which is simply symbolized by the capital Q. The Q moves to complex 3, and basically we continue our discussion. Complex 3 pumps protons, hands the electrons off to cytochrome C. The electrons move from cytochrome C to complex 4, where oxygen is the final electron acceptor, and more protons are translocated, and those protons can flow through ATP synthase and bring about effectively the synthesis of more ATP. So now we are in a position to summarize our discussion of cellular respiration. During our discussion of glycolysis, we saw that we started with glucose and we ended up with two pyruvate molecules. In the process, we formed some ATP. Specifically, we formed two net ATPs. The pyruvate is then transformed into acetyl-CoA through the pyruvate dehydrogenase complex reactions. This formed an NADH. The acetyl-CoA then entered the citric acid cycle, and we formed one GTP, which I said was equivalent to an ATP in terms of energy. But importantly, we formed three NADHs and one FADH2. Those electrons were then handed through the electron transport chain, where oxygen was the final electron acceptor, and we formed water. One thing I didn't mention is that we form a lot more ATP by undergoing oxidative phosphorylation than we do by simply undergoing glycolysis. So if a cell is aerobic, it is to its advantage to undergo oxidative phosphorylation. It's much more efficient. You get a lot more ATP formed as a result of oxidative phosphorylation. So now we're ready to summarize our discussion. We saw that the pyruvate, which was formed in glycolysis, enters the mitochondrial matrix and is oxidatively decarboxylated to acetyl-CoA and carbon dioxide. The acetyl-CoA enters the citric acid cycle by condensing with oxaloacetate and forming citrate. One turn of the TCA cycle converts citrate, a 6-carbon compound, back into oxaloacetate, a 4-carbon compound. Along the way, 2 carbon dioxides were released, 1 GTP was formed, 3 NADHs were formed, and 1 FADH2 was formed. When we follow the electrons, we see that the NADHs and the FADH2 hand off their electrons to the electron transport chain, which in turn leads to the production of ATP. This aerobic process is much more efficient than the anaerobic process of glycolysis.